Can you that bin that binder has all three exams, each form in it. When are your office hours?
Tuesday, Thursday, 11 to noon.
At Physics Building?
Yes.
Okay. 11 to noon. Go ahead and take those anyways, in case students want to talk to you about their exams and go over them. Okay, I'll tell you more about that later. Okay, students, could you give me a mic from over there? Let's get rolling. Okay, this is working. Our outline for today is to wrap up the HR diagram and talk about the DNA of stars, and hopefully we'll get to that. Before we do that, however, I would like to review a couple ideas and concepts from exam three. First of all, I have been looking at the clicker data. Here are the answers. You may recall typing in numbers like those. There was plenty of people that got it right on the money. There were some answers that I want to give partial credit to, so that's why that part of the score is not posted yet. Usually it's a little faster for me, but this one, there's a lot of people that are rounding off, you know, a little bit shaky, so I have to decide whether to give it partial credit. In other words, 2 or 1 point instead of just 0. But a lot of you got these answers right on the money. Now, a couple of other things I want to go over with you about the exam. Now that eventually exam three will be graded. The Scantrons aren't ready yet, and the clicking isn't ready yet, but eventually they will be. And when they are, we'll be able to execute our best 2 out of 3 maneuver. All right, so right now, in web courses, you just have exam one and exam two. That's all anybody has. But after this one's scored and I post the total and everything, you'll have 3 exam scores, most of you, and I'll be able to then put in a new row in your grades page labeled best 2 out of 3. And that's the one that goes into your semester grade, right, for most of you. Now, some of you have been absent on exam day, and that means that you'll have just one, just the two that you do have, whether it's 1 and 2, 2 and 3, 1 and 3. But most of you are going to have a choice, and that'll be pretty nice. Another thing I want to go over with you is the participation pointage, and right now, as of last Thursday, our last regular lecture, there were 42 questions. Okay, now I uploaded some a roundup, I think last Wednesday, 39 questions, but then on Thursday last week we had 3 more questions. So right now the total is 42. And so you either get 25 out of 25 if you've answered 82% of those, or you have to solve the proportion. And I want to review that with you so that you can have an example. Now, first of all, full pointage. 85% of 42 is 35.7 questions. So if you have 36 or more answered, okay, in your roundup number, that's the whole number part. The decimal part, remember, tells you how many you got correct. And that's valid too at the end of the semester, maybe for bonus points. But right now I'm explaining your regular clicking percentage. So if you have 36 or more, you're automatically over 85% and you get 25 out of 25. So go ahead and put a box around that little experiment. You know, some of you, you know, like I was looking at somebody's grades this morning, they had 38 out of 39 as of last Wednesday. All right. And so You know, they might have 41 out of 42 now. So now I haven't put this number up yet, but I'm going to be putting it up so you'll have an estimate of your points. But you can do it too. Now, if you're below 85%, let's do an example of that. And there's going to be a bunch of you that have to calculate this, so that's all right. Now, let's say that you have 26 answers out of 42. Now, that's 61.905%, right, which is what I've got here in the first equation block in the second example. 26 over 42, 0.61905. And you can verify that if you have your calculator out. And so you're below 85, so that means you have to drop that percentage into this proportion. You put it in the numerator, and in the denominator, you put 85%, 0.85. And then on the other side, you put, you know, X or whatever symbol you want to use, or just my points, your points, in the numerator, and then 25, that's the baseline for, you know, full pointage. Now, you might actually, with rounding up that I normally do, you might actually come up with 25, you know, so 41 out of, 35 out of 42 might actually come up with 25 points. But anyways, this one's decidedly below the 85% mark. So you cross multiply, okay? And when you cross multiply, you get the 25 over to the left, up in the numerator now, and then you just do that calculation. So 0.619 times 25 divided by 0.85, that's equal to 18.2. Now, always remember, on this one, I always round up. Right? So even though, you know, in math class, you would round down to 18, for participation pointage and also for homework pointage, I always round up just to give you guys a benefit. It's not the benefit of the doubt, but it's just to give you guys a break. So anyways, so that one would be 19 out of 25. Now, another thing I want to mention to you is, okay, here's your second example. Put a box around that. Another thing I want to mention to you is exams don't get scaled down or anything. They just go straight into your pointage total. Okay? It's clicking and homework scores that get converted. Okay? And the total, you know, so at any point in the semester, your homework is worth 15 points. And at any point in the semester, your clicking is worth 25 points. But right now, we have 42 clicker questions, whereas, you know, a couple of months ago, we only had like 19. So the number of questions changes, but the pointage is always based on 25 for participation and 15 for homework. So let's do a homework pointage. Right now, we have homework of 37 as of, I think it was homework 6, the study assignment prior to exam 3 that was due Tuesday. Total of 37 points that you could have. And so what we got to do is convert that to 15 points and then round up. So now this one, you don't do any proportions or anything. It's not like participation. This one, you know, it's web courses, homework, usually. So you just got to do it. And everybody's expected to do all of it. So you just calculate your percentage. So here's an example. Let's say that this student has 30 questions or has 30 homework points out of 37 possible. And we'll have some more homework over the weekend and next week and so forth. We're not done with this yet, but right now 37. Okay, so that's 81.08%. All right, that's not too bad. You know, it's not 100%. A lot of you guys have 100% on the homework, which is good. All right. So anyways, you just multiply 15, you know, times 0.8108. In other words, you get 81.08% of the 15 points. And that works out to 12.16. And oh, don't forget to round up. So this student gets 13 out of 15. All right. And for many of you, you're going to, if you don't have 40 out of 40 between participation and homework, you're 39 out of 40 or 38 out of 40. You're still doing pretty good. All right. And some of you are a little bit shaky on that. But for those of you that are a little bit shaky, I'll go ahead and draw a box around this example. You know, we're going to have some more bonus point opportunities. Now, before we go to the bonus point situation, let me pause for questions. Yes. I'll explain that in a second. Okay. I want questions about clicking and homework. Sophia, does your seatmate, your next door neighbor there, does she have a question? Do you have a question? Yeah. Yeah. You were looking up there. You had kind of a quizzical look on your face.
No, I was working it out in
my head. Yeah. Okay, good. Just checking. All right. Now let's talk about bonus points. The way that bonus points work is they're just out there in your bin. They go into the numerator. I mean, if you're thinking percentages right now, you know, we have 140 points possible, and you have some homework points, and you have some participation points and exam points. Those go in the numerator. You add them up, and they go in the numerator. And then the denominator is already always 140. Now, bonus points always go into the numerator, but they don't change the denominator. So, for instance, what? Okay, you listening now? Okay. When I give you guys the final exam, the denominator will go to 240 because that's the last big thing in the books right now. Okay. But when I add bonus points in, I don't change the denominator of anything. I mean, so your denominator is just regular pointage events, participation, homework, exams, midterms, best two out of three. And then after the semester, your final, and then that brings up to 240. So the bonus points, they just go in the numerator, you know. So if you have, you know, like 70 points on exam two and 20 points on clicking, and 15 points, 70 plus 20 is 90 plus 15, that's 105, okay? Those are your regular points. And then just, you know, if you have one observatory visit, that's another 8, so you have a total of 113, but it's still divided by 140. If I were given letter grades today, which I'm not, but I mean, to estimate where you stand going into the final, basically, that's how you would do it, okay? Every bonus point that you have, another way to think about it is, everybody in here is going to take the final. And so every bonus point that you earn, you can think of, well, that's one more point on the final that I don't need to get an A or to get a B or to get a C or, you know, to pass with a D. All right. So that's another way to look at it. You know, and they don't disappear. So, you know, sometimes I give bonus points on exams, you know, like I give 51 Scantron questions, you know, so the 51st question is a bonus point question, okay? Those don't go away, and even if that exam gets dropped. So anyway, so does that answer kind of, is that satisfactory? Okay. All right. Now, we've got an observatory session maybe. So if you have coming up, this is, today's the 5th, so this is two Thursdays from now, and actually it's the last Thursday of the semester, regular part of the semester, and our final is a week after that, on the 26th, apparently. Is that correct from the syllabus? It's the 26th. So a couple weeks from now, maybe one more session, if the weather cooperates. So if you haven't gotten out there, this is your last chance. All right. But if you can if your schedule, you know, you work at Disney or something, making the big bucks, or wherever you work, you can't make it, which I know some of you can't, There's going to be two bonus point opportunities, that one in class. We're going to do some clicking on the last day of class, kind of a mega review clicking session. And then there's going to be a mega review homework in web courses. And that will also give you some bonus points if you do well on it. So I'm usually set it up to be 4 points from the in-class review clicking, and then 4 points from the homework. So even if you haven't had the chance, you can still bag at least 8 bonus points and do a little studying and review for the final, which is also highly recommended. All right, questions again before we continue with astronomy. Daniel?
Will there be extra points too with clicking if you get 75% of the questions correct?
Yeah, bonus points. The reason I calculate or I tally up how many correct answers you get is because I wasn't going to mention it, but you bring it up. If you have 75%, what's 75% of 42? That's 10, 30, 30.75. No, 31.5. So if you have 32 or more right now correct, that's 75. So if you get a B on your clicking questions, and right now that would be 32 or more, then correct, 32 or more correct, then you get 4 bonus points at the end of the semester. And there'll be a bunch of you that are at that point right now. And if you're not at that point right now, if you're close to it, but you're not there, boom, go get it. All right, go up there and get it. You know, I talk to students every day about their grades. And sometimes I talk to a student, you know, they're on the borderline right now between a B and an A. And I always tell the student, I always say, go get me that A. Go get it. If you earn it, you got it. Because, you know, some instructors, they grade on a curve. And you know what that means is, even if you get enough points, you might not get an A, because only a certain number of A's, certain number of F's, certain number of B's, C's, and D's. And so, but not with me. Our job, my job, and your job is to break that curve into smithereens. And we're doing it. We got to, you know, I did a distribution of the grades, and there's more B's in here right now than there are C's. There's a good pile of C's. You know, there's a good pile of C's, a even bigger pile of B's, and you know what? There's a decent number of A's in here too. So if you get it, if you earn it, you got it. Just like they say on the Toyota commercial. You want it, you got it, Toyota. All right, so I don't do any of that curving business. That's for, I don't even know what that's for. That's like for the SAT and ACT. Did you know that the SAT is a curve? And that the average every year is supposed to be 500. Did you know that? Yeah. It's based every year. So if you say, wow, you know, the average score, if you get a 500 on a really difficult test, you still have a 500. And if the next year it's a really easy test by some, you know, chance, and you get a 500, that means you got a 500 on a really easy test. They don't tell you that, but that's how that scoring system, you know, from 200 up to 800, and then you add them together, and it's SAT. Let's talk about astronomy. It's much, much more easy to understand. Okay, Vega, I want to point something out. You're going to have some homework over the weekend concerning Vega and some other stars. Vega. A bluish-white star, it's in the constellation Lyra, which is a summer constellation. And I'll never forget the first time I really, that was graven into my mind. Last day of August. And I was looking at constellation Lyra. Anyway, The Vega is a star that we use to anchor the luminosity rating system called the magnitude system. Now, we're going to try to stay away from magnitudes. You can definitely read about it in the textbook. It's kind of a backwards, and I shouldn't say backwards, it's kind of a counterintuitive. We're going to try to stay to solar luminosity scales in this class, but the magnitude system is in the book. You can read about it, and Vega is used to anchor that. Vega has zero magnitude to first order. Another cool thing about Vega is that it is spinning really, really fast, and so this is actually the shape of it. It's no longer, Vega is not a sphere. It's boom. It's flattening out. It's spinning so fast. And guess what? You know, if it spins a little bit faster, it'll break apart. You know, and that's one of the things that they, you know, the rings of Saturn are from we think, from a moon or something, that got so close, the tidal deformation stretched it out in the direction from the moon to the center of Saturn, you know, so longitudinally, it stretched it out like spaghetti, but it never made it to spaghetti status. But it's, if it stretched out the moon a little bit more than this, bang, it just breaks apart. And if something's spinning, you know, if something is deformed like this because it's spinning a little bit faster than this, a little bit more deformation, bang, it'll break apart. It won't hold together. So it's a lot of cool things in the universe. Anyway, so I'll give you an additional reading assignment. It's actually from Popular Mechanics. I was reading it last night myself, and I thought, you know, this would make a great homework assignment just to back up the stuff that we're learning about the color luminosity relation. In other words, the HR diagram. So let's get back to this color luminosity. You know, we're hiring a couple new astronomy profs, planetary science profs in the physics department, and there one of the candidates gave, did you go to that talk yesterday? She gave a talk yesterday, you know, like a seminar, and she had a color luminosity chart for planets, dwarf stars that are actually considered gigantic planets. And so, you know, the things that, now we're going to mostly do stars, but she was actually doing color luminosity for giant planets. It's kind of cool. So chapter 17.3, now we've mentioned this already, that there's patterns in the spectral lines. Now these big dents in the spectrum, you know, the spectrum is, you know, theoretically is a nice smooth curve, depending on the temperature. And we've looked at those before. All right. But the real thing that they actually measure, like this one, has got absorption features out the wazoo, those big dents. What that means is there's not as much light coming at that color. Okay? You know, you can see it's this is real, you know, wavelength by wavelength, you know, every 2 nanometers or whatever it is, they measure the intensity, then they go to the next one. Another 2 nanometers up and measure that. Another 2, and they just inch across the spectrum, and they measure. And some of the frequencies, some of the wavelengths, have big dips. In other words, it's dim. All right, and that means it's absorption. These are absorption features here. And you can see emission features in some stars as well. You know, and that's where the curve would have a bump on it. You know, like a zit. Hopefully nobody's ever had a zit like that. But anyways, you'd have some kind of upward spike. But these are all downward spikes. These are absorption features. Now, the spectral types that we have talked about, OBA, FGKM, we're going to talk a little bit more about them. Each of those is graded from 0 to 9. Okay, so there's 10 groups from 0 to 9. All right, so for instance, the Sun and Alpha Centauri A and B, are G2s, all right? And they're a little bit redder than a G0. a little bit bluer than a G4, right? And all the spectral classes, you know, B1, A0, you know, F4, you know, you can have all kinds of those. And you can look it up on the internet. For instance, Sirius is A1, right? Alpha Centauri C is pretty red. It's an M-class star, 5.5, M5.5. So it's down there in the middle of the reds. It's kind of pokey. But it's actually the closest star to us. It's also called Proxima Centauri. And so, this being the case, these spectral types are basically related to the surface temperature, and the luminosity is independent, kind of independent of that, because some of the stars might be really large, some might be really small. So right now we have a very handy scheme that allows us to quantify, spectral types. Here's another picture from, this is from 17.3. Different spectral types, OBA, FGKM, and different temperatures. You know, this is figure 2 from 17.3. And it's, I love this, this is a nice diagram because it shows that the spectral lines become prominent, absorption lines, by temperature. So up there in the really hot surface of an O-class star, you're going to see a lot of ionized helium absorption features, all right? But then if you're in a B-class star, let me get my cursor over here. Ooh, I forgot to make my cursor big. Sorry, guys. Okay, so neutral helium is unionized. Okay, so this flavor of helium might look a little bit more like what we saw in class. Okay, and that's down the 10 to 30,000 Kelvin range, right? And G2, that's over right about here. Okay, so neutral metals, and we can see sodium in the spectrum. That's a metal. It's considered a metal. And to an astronomer, everything higher on the periodic table than helium is considered a metal. You know, a regular scientist, no, but for astronomers, they consider everything above helium a metal. Anyways, and this is kind of cool. You know, these cool red M-class stars down here, so these are the red ones. It says molecular titanium oxide. Nice. Yeah, so, and titanium is a metal. Oxygen, to an astronomer, is a metal. It's a molecule. You know, we use titanium oxide for a pigment here on Earth. Here's another way to look at it. Here's the different classes from 06.5, A5, and on down to M5, the stuff. And you can see, now, on this one, you don't see those big dents in the spectrum, because this is an actual eyeball view. Really fine grain eyeball view. Now, when you're looking at the spectrum of the sun through a prism or diffraction grating, or the spectrum of a incandescent light, you don't really pick these up, these gaps, but they're there. And if you take very careful photography, very precise, you can pick these up, these gaps. So those are absorption features, and you can see that the different, you know, different features appear and then disappear as you go down the... So like right here, down here in the M's, where's my cursor? Come on, baby. I can't even see it. Anyways, down here in the M's in the middle, M5, you got a bunch of absorption features, but up there in the 06.5, you don't have jack. You know, so if you look in the greens and yellows here, in the middle of M5, you have a lot of absorption lines, but up there in 06.5, they're there a little bit maybe, but not nearly as prominent, and that's because of the surface temperature. All right, know, certain spectral lines will light up, or will appear, I should say, according to temperature. Now, here's another diagram. I like this one because it gives each spectral class, you know, OBA, FGKM. It gives an example. And actually, this is from another textbook, so I'm not supposed to be using this, but it is really nice. You can see diagrams like this on the internet. Each class has an example, you know, like for B class, Rigel. And it gives a B-class spectrum. It's kind of idealized. And you see down there in the M-class, Betelgeuse, Proxima Centauri, two completely different stars, but their surface temperatures are similar and their spectral lines are similar. Now, the sun is kind of right in here, right? And so it says weak hydrogen lines. So you get a little bit of hydrogen absorption, but not much. Strong lines of ionized calcium. And we can see calcium in the surface of the sun, sodium, bunch of different metals. So we have these spectral types, and it really is helpful to look at stars, but and they seem to be most stars in these seven spectral types. But then the other thing that's independent, kind of, is how bright it is. So that's where the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, the HR diagram, comes in, also known as the color luminosity graph. Here it is. This is some stars from the Hipparcos satellite that was orbiting about 20 years ago. It's now out of commission. The Gaius satellite is up there now, measuring Buku stars. If you can get it's easy to get the spectral type and to get the apparent brightness. But if you can also get the parallax, you can figure out the absolute brightness, you know, the absolute luminosity, and then you can compare them. And that's the vertical scale here. So all these stars here, if you plot up their luminosity in terms of the luminosity of the sun, so like right here, cursor, where are you? I can't even come on, cursor. There it is. Okay, so right here, luminosity one. So the sun is going to plot up right in here somewhere. All right, and so here's the G's. Okay, and there's the one solar. Now, these ones down here, 1/100th of the luminosity. So these are dim. All right. If you were 10 parsecs away from each of these stars, the brightness of each would tell you the distance exactly. Or excuse me, the bright apparent brightness of each would tell you the absolute brightness. Now up here, these stars up here at the upper end are about 100 times as luminous as the sun. And this is a pattern. Can you see this pattern? This kind of line, kind of snaking down from the upper left down to the lower right. That's not an accident. You know, every star that we see just about falls somewhere, 90% of the stars that we see fall somewhere into that. That's called the main sequence. So go ahead and label that. So make a luminosity graph vertically and a spectral type graph. The spectral type, surface temperature, all right? And vertical luminosity. And so the most stars are on that main sequence, that diagonal from upper left to lower right. And the Earth and the Sun is kind of in the middle of it. Here's another. And these ones out here, let me get my cursor here. These ones up here in this secondary group up here, notice how this is correlates to 10 radii of the sun, and this one corresponds to one radius of the sun, and this lower green line corresponds to a tenth of the radius of the sun. And what that means is the HR diagram, the color luminosity chart, can tell you based on luminosity and surface color. You know, surface color tells us how many watts per square meter. Luminosity tells us how many, you know, how many square meters you've got. If you know how many square meters you got, you know the radius. And so this group up here, this kind of secondary group, those are giant stars. McKeegan's particle came from one of those babies that eventually blew up in a supernova. All right, now, this is a color chart, luminosity in solar units on the vertical, and notice this one. This is from a different source. It's not from the textbook. 20,000 kelvins. This one doesn't have color or spectral type. It has surface temperature. So 6,000, the sun is right in here somewhere. Yeah, that's about right. Okay, here's another one. And you can see that the giant stars are up here. But see where it's red. What red means in this diagram is how many stars are there. All right, how crowded is it? All right, so the red here and the dark red means that that's the part of the main sequence that's got tons of stars. Now, this one is a little different. I believe this is Gaia, the HR diagram from Gaia. And this one is rated vertically in something called absolute magnitude. Now, don't worry about that. It still means bright at the top, dim at the bottom, even though the magnitude number is bigger at the bottom and it's actually negative up at the top. That's the way the magnitude system works. So it's kind of, you know, the other thing about magnitudes, you might want to write this down in your notes, logarithms. Logarithms. Now, write it down in your notes and then cross it out because we're not going to do any logarithms. But that's why we kind of avoid the magnitude system, because it's based on logarithms. Another thing down here, color index, J minus K. That's a numerical way of rating the color. And it's based on the magnitude system too. But anyways, it's basically brighter towards the top, dimmer towards the bottom, bluer towards the left, redder towards the right. Color magnitude. Now, here's a little blurb on Gaia. Hipparchos got 118,000 stars, approximately, out to about 500 light years. But Gaia, oh my goodness. Gaia's distance is many times more than that. So we're getting on the other side of the galaxy. I mean, if we can see it, if it's not obscured by, you know, nebulas and stuff, you know, we can, you know, Gaia's going to be cooking up there for a long time. And the more that it gets, the better our HR diagram looks. Now, you can read about Gaia. It's European Space Agency. It's pretty nice. Pretty nice spacecraft. This is figure 3 from 18-4. And this one marks the sun, okay, in the G2 area. Okay, and you can see that Alpha Centauri A is right next to it. And here's another. And Betelgeuse is way up here. It's kind of hard to see in the computer screen, but it's in your textbook, figure 3, chapter 18.4. And here's another one. It's figure 4. This one's a little more idealized, but has spectral class across the bottom, and it has surface temperature as well. And so this one is also kind of counterintuitive. In other words, the high temperature is on the left, the low temperature is on the right, right? But it has the luminosity of the sun, you know. So way up here, 10 to the 6, there's a few stars up here, my friend, that are a million times more luminous than the SUN. All right, but 90% of the stars that we observe, you know, we get a parallax, we get a spectrum, bing, we can map it out on the HR. Yeah, they're down here on the somewhere on the HR diagram. Now, these ones down towards the bottom, they're pretty dim. So we can't see many of them on the other side of the galaxy. But these guys up here, we can, you know, if there's no nebula in the way, you know, a million times the luminosity of the sun, you know, we're going to see something like that at quite a distance. So there's a little bit of bias, a little bit of distance bias in this. But the more Gaia can get, the better this will be. So we got giants, super giants, white dwarf stars. Let me go backwards here. Right, white dwarf stars down here. They're real. Now look at this bindle of stars called white dwarfs. Okay, they're over there in the O, B, and A area. So they're really hot. Every square meter is burning off a lot of photons. They're really, really hot. Problem is they're pretty small, so they're not really very high up on the luminosity scale. They're on the left, so they're hot, but they're not very luminous. That tells us that they're small. And that's why we call them white dwarfs. All right, so here's my little animation again. Nice. All right, let's do some double checking here, okay, just to get your brain cooking. And you know, your brain is your number one weapon. When you assume superhero status after getting your degree at UCF, remember, your number one weapon against all the figures of evil is your mind. It's your number one weapon. All right, how does it go? Bluish stars. Upper left, middle, lower right. Bluish stars anywhere? No bluish stars. Now this is main sequence. This is the figure from your textbook, so you can relate this question to the textbook. Okay. 20 seconds. How long have we been going on this?
I started with the transcript.
Okay. Doesn't this usually say how many seconds it goes? Oh, there it is. Yeah, okay. 40 seconds. Okay, 15 seconds to vote. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Go ahead and switch over to this one. Okay, go ahead and switch to computer. Okay. All right, now here's your distribution. Let's make this a little bit bigger. Okay, here's your distribution. Whoa. And a lot of you voted for A, and a lot of you voted for D. And this. Oh, Lord, you turned it back.
I didn't do it.
Jenny. Good gravy. You slackers. It's all right. It's all right. Stuff happens. Anyways, the correct answer is upper left. Yeah, now we're talking main sequence, right? So that means that diagonal. Now, there's blue stars on the HR diagram. You know, the white dwarfs are down there, but matter of fact, let's ask another main sequence question. Let's be careful this time. All right. Which are intrinsically dimmest? Did I do that or did you do it?
No, I'm not paying attention.
You know, stuff happens, so it's just, you know, this is good. Go ahead and do this. 30 seconds. Make your decision. Can you change the question type to short answer on the first one?
I can try.
I mean, after we close the section. See if you can do that and then just give everybody. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Ding. Yeah, you guys did good. Lower right. Option C is correct. Classes K and M. So, and believe it or not, we think that there's a lot of those babies. They're just, some of them are harder to see the further you are away from Earth. All right, let's use the color luminosity chart to think. That, and my wonderful students, this is the thing that astronomers the world over do all the time. The HR diagram is for us now. Now that we've got a bunch of stars, you know, thousands of stars that we can put into an HR diagram, it's now a tool for us, a tool to help us think about what's happening. Now, this is an HR diagram here of the stars in the Pleiades, all right? And it's got apparent magnitude. This, you could do apparent brightness, apparent luminosity, and color. And that's what this one does. This is apparent magnitude V for the Pleiades. And what this tells you is, it tells you how far away the Pleiades are. You can judge the distance by where they are on the HR diagram and where they appear to be on the luminosity. So all the G2s in the Pleiades on this graph are at some apparent magnitude, but if they were on an absolute magnitude, absolute luminosity chart, they'd be at a different position vertically. So that tells you the distance. You work out the distance. But to do that, you have to use logarithms and stuff. So we're going to bypass that. But we can talk about the giant branch. So this is from 18.4. How can a star be at once cool, meaning each square meter on the star does not put out all that much energy, and yet very luminous? So an example is Betelgeuse. The only way for that to be true is for the star to be enormous. And that's why we have up here the giants, the red giants, and the supergiants. Now, if you look carefully at this diagram from the textbook, you'll see, you see any blue giants? Yeah. These guys right up here. See, this is the blue side. And here's some stars up here that are way more luminous than the same color on the main sequence. All right? So these stars must be giants or supergiants, the stars of huge diameter that we discussed earlier. So McKeegan's particle came from one of these red giants getting blown up. And so now we get to the position where we have to think. All right, we got this HR diagram, we got some patterns, we've got some secondary patterns, you know, the giants, the supergiants, and notice that the supergiants, there's not many of them, but there's plenty of red giants, regular giants, and there's giants of other colors, you know, orange and stuff. Anyways, red giants, why are they different? In other words, why do they land at a different place outside the main sequence? You know, there's gravity, there's nuclear fusion, but why is it different? You know, the answer is physics. So here's the logic, okay? There are different fusion reactions cooking at the core of a red giant. And our star is mainly cooking hydrogen into helium. And statistically speaking, there's probably a small amount of carbon and nitrogen and oxygen being cooked up. but mostly hydrogen into helium. Giant stars, different fusion processes altogether. And why is that? It's because the core is a different temperature, higher temperature. And what the higher temperature does means you have to expand, you know, things that are hot expand, okay? So the outer surface expands so far because of the heat, but then the outer, when it eventually stabilizes, it's pretty cool, and that's why it's red instead of blue. But the core, which you don't see, is a different temperature. And why is that? Because the mass of the star is different. Some stars become red giants, some stars do not. Now, let me ask you a question. All right, so this is, we're getting towards the topic of supernovas here. Let me ask you another clicker question. You ready? Why is the subpopulation in the lower left given the name of dwarf? Let's see if I can start this question. Why is that one called a dwarf? I mean, we've got the giants and super giants up towards the top, and then we got these babies down here in the dwarf status, but why is that? What's the logic? You're in a court of law, the court of scientific law. How do you state your case? Your prosecution. ...20 seconds to vote. ...10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Yeah, most of you got this one correct. The surface is hot, but they don't actually produce much light. Now, if you want, that English sentence corresponds to two mathematical facts, all right? The surface is hot means it's over here on the left side of the HR diagram. Okay, so everything on the left side of the HR diagram has a hot surface. But now it's the second scientific fact is it's dipped down. It's got a low luminosity number, right? So we can get a parallax, figure out how many watts, you know, burning off this star, and then we map it. You know, we compare it to the sun. Oops, these babies are way dimmer than the sun. And a white dwarf star is about the size of Earth, you know, the size of a planet. And it's what's left after the evolution of a lot of main sequence stars, which we'll talk about on Tuesday probably. So here's our question. Why does the HR diagram stack up in this particular way? Here's another question. You know, what is the physics that forces stars to, or most of them, to rearrange themselves or to find themselves somewhere on that path, on that diagonal pattern? So as I've mentioned before, 90% of the stars are located on the main sequence of the HR diagram. So if we can identify some activity or life stage with the main sequence, then it follows that stars must spend 90% of their lives in that activity or life stage. Now, here's where the guys at the national labs like Oak Ridge and Lawrence Livermore and Los Alamos, you know, they're figuring out how to detonate a hydrogen bomb, right? And so they know all about hydrogen fusion. But they can also use similar physics and expertise to figure out this big hydrogen self-contained, self-gravitating reaction. It's controlled, and the computer models show that stars evolve over time, and a typical star will spend about 90% of its life fusing the abundant hydrogen in its core into fusion, excuse me, into helium. All right, so everything on the main sequence is basic universe 101, hydrogen fusion into helium. Most of the visible universe is hydrogen, you know, gram for gram. That it appears to be, you know, like I said at the very first day of class, about 75% of the visible universe is hydrogen, about 24% is helium. Right, and that's kind of reflected here. Now, those stars don't always burn helium and stuff, or excuse me, burn hydrogen. Eventually, the giant stars are going to start fusing helium. All right, and that is a completely different nuclear reaction. And then, of course, the white dwarf stars, according to our models, they're really hot, but they're not fusing. Unless you accidentally drop a big blob of hydrogen from another star onto the surface of a white dwarf, and then you'll get a detonation. You know, just a, you know, and that's what we call a supernova. That's one of the kinds of supernovas. You know, a white dwarf star that gets a blob from another nearby star, you know, maybe it's a part of a binary star pair. But in itself, if it's by itself, if it's not part of a binary star system, it's just going to kind of stay hot and radiate off that energy into space and eventually become a brown dwarf and then just kind of a cinder. So, statement three, conclusion. Astrophysicists have been, and this is from your textbook, have been able to show that the structure of stars that are in equilibrium and derive all their energy from nuclear fusion is completely and uniquely determined by just two quantities, the total mass and the composition of the star. Now, the composition of the star means that you have like maybe a little bit more helium or a little bit more hydrogen than the average. But most stars are going to have, you know, those proportions that I mentioned. And so what that means is that the mass of a star, you know, when it forms from these big swirling nebulas, you know, and the nebulas, they, you know, they swirl and they burl and, you know, they boil and bubble, and eventually they start to conglomerate into, you know, subnebulas, and then that subnebula starts to spin, and then you start forming planets, and in the middle of it you maybe have a big blob, or maybe your nebula is big enough to have two main blobs. That's going to be a binary star, you know. And most stars in the universe, do you have to take off? Okay. Oh, you're putting on your jacket. Okay, excuse me. So most stars that we see in the universe are part of binary star systems. Okay, so a lot of those nebulas, a lot of those subnebulas are big enough to have two decent-sized stars. Now, we're in a single star system. We're not part. But Alpha Centauri is part of a triple star system. Two G2 stars, and then a little M, even more than two. So the mass of the star tells you how hot, basically how hot the center of the star is going to be. And that tells you how fast it fuses. Okay? And it also places it precisely on the main sequence. So here's your hydrogen fusion. Whoops. Here's your hydrogen fusion on the main sequence. And the stars at the upper left of the main sequence are high mass stars. Okay? So make a note of that. Upper left, O, B, and A stars So like Sirius is a lot higher mass than the sun. And then the middle, you know, the suns, you get about, you know, stars like Alpha Centauri and stuff, about the same mass as the sun. And then down in the lower right, the little red stars, those are little ones. And they have mass, they have enough mass to start a nuclear fusion reaction in the core, but it's not a big pile. In other words, they're just a little teeny fraction of their core is hot enough to fuse hydrogen. But those big jobs at the upper left, the OBs and As, they've got so much mass that they have a big fusion core. And what that means is they burn through it a lot faster. The bigger the star, the shorter its lifetime. Let me repeat that. The bigger the mass, the shorter the lifetime. And you know, DNA tells you a lot of stuff about a person. You know, a little baby before it's even born, you know, if you know it's DNA, you can tell, you know, like its fingerprints, what color eyes it's going to have, how tall it's going to be, that little baby, and, you know, how fast it's going to be able to run on the track team, and all kinds of stuff, you know, is going to be, is it going to have long curly eyelashes or kind of short eyelashes? Is it going to need specs, you know, in high school and college or not, you know? Is it going to have x-ray vision? You know, some people have really good vision, you know, but, and that's all controlled by DNA. And of course, the other thing that controls how a person grows up is, you know, where they grow up, you know, so the environment also has it, and that's true about stars as well. All right, so the star's mass places it precisely somewhere on the main sequence. Now, this diagram here is kind of an idealized main sequence. It's the result of a calculation, right? And so the scientists at Los Alamos say, all right, we've got a hydrogen core, and they set the mass to, you know, 23 times the mass of the sun. And then, all right, then they let their equation cook in the computer. And they figure out, all right, it's going to have a luminosity, it's going to have a size, it's going to have a lifetime of a certain. Now, so up here, in the upper right, this is like 23 times the mass of the sun. Here's 2.0 times the mass of the sun, all right? And if you look at it, you can see 1, and then down here is 0.51, yeah. So the most massive stars have the most gravity and thus can compress their centers to the greatest degree. This is a quote from your textbook. This means that they are hottest inside. And so as the star consumes its hydrogen, it converts it to helium, and eventually the source of energy changes, as do the chemical composition and interior structure. All right, so and we'll talk about that a little bit more next week, and that's because the core, once you stop fusing hydrogen and you're not quite hot enough to start fusing helium, the core is going to shrink down a little bit until it gets hot again and hot enough to burn helium. And then you start cooking up other elements, you know, like carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen. All the elements in the periodic table up to about iron, number 26, can be cooked up in the center of a star, depending on how big it is. All right? And so after it leaves the equilibrium, the fusion of hydrogen, it goes off the main sequence. And the main sequence, leaving the main sequence means the star is going to its retirement home. It's moving to Florida, retiring and moving to Florida. You know, so it might go to white dwarf status or red giant. But eventually, if it's a big enough star, it's going to go into supernova. So next week, you can start reading about supernovas. Next week, it's going to be our main topic. And then after that, wait a minute now. After that, the very last week of the semester will be Black Holes Week. All right, you're dismissed. I'll see you next week for Supernova Week. See if you can change that to... let me get my cursor. There we go.